everybody else, they kept, they're thinking it's all about them. I'm ready. It was amazing how many of our people don't understand why you have to own. And I've been saying all around the country, we got to own our narrative.
That's it.
I said, you can't, I said, we cannot be in a position where we're asking somebody else to tell our story. Ready? All right, folks, glad to have all of you here. We are at the YouTube studios here in New York City, and been waiting to have this conversation with Spike Lee. What's up, man?
What's up, baby?
Good seeing you.
How the Rock is doing?
Rock is doing well. See, doing well. You know,
better than the Knicks, so, right?
There's a whole bunch of folks doing better than the Knicks. Yeah, come on. First of all, we're going to talk about Black Klansmen, but as a basketball fan, you've been in purgatory for a long time.
True. As Jay-Z would say, facts.
But you got all brothers running the show now.
Yeah.
So, you got some hope?
Hope is eternal. When you're a Knicks fan.
I understand.
Thanks for having me. You know, this is how I look. You're doing your thing, baby. Appreciate it.
Well, the thing is, you know, it was very interesting. You know, I had a Sunday morning show on TV1 for 4 years, mm-hmm. a daily show for 4 years. Mm-hmm. Had you on those shows, and when TV1 ended the show, I said, folks were like, oh man, you know, but man, love to have you on CNN, MSNBC. And I said, no, I said, we're gonna launch a digital show, mm-hmm. Which we're gonna launch Roland Martin Unfiltered September 4th. Mm-hmm. And my whole deal was, I said, because in which you understand, we talked about this beforehand, mm-hmm. we've got to own our narrative. We've got to tell our story, and we can't be in a position of having, asking somebody else, please.
Can't do it.
Right, and in fact, what's interesting is, so I put out this goal. I wanted 20,000 of our followers to contribute $50 each to be a part of our Bring the Funk fan club. And the whole point of that is if we do that, that's $1 million that's come from the fans. And I've told folks, look, we also have to fund our freedom. Mm-hmm. It can't just be, but go get some advertising. Like, yeah, but you're still beholden right. to if they don't. And you did a movie, which I contributed to when you crowdfunded.
Yeah, Kickstarter.
Right. And that's just.
Appreciate it.
And in fact, you were crowdfunding before the name even existed.
Yeah, 1985, but she's going to have it.
Tell folks about that, because I don't think people really understand
well,
that.
Well, we were doing crowdfunding before it was called crowdfunding. You know, I was writing letters, pen to paper, postcards, pen to postcards, calling people up to contribute. And she's going to have it cost $175,000. And you know Nelson George, you know Nelson, right?
Oh yeah.
He was one of the original investors.
Wow.
He's still getting checks. 32 years later.
Wow.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm sure glad I answered your letter.
Nah, I knew Nelson. He was like, but you know, you're right. It's ownership, and that goes whatever you want to do, whatever endeavor. And it's ironic, you know, when things were segregated, we had our business.
Yep.
We support our businesses.
Yep.
We support our people. And then it flipped. So here we are, 2018.
And when we also talk about owning the narrative, what I explain to people all the time is that if being in this position, I'm deciding the topics, the guests, mm-hmm. I'm deciding how much time we spend.
But you know what you call that? What I call that? You're the gatekeeper.
There you go.
And that's the problem, because people, you know, everybody's excited now, black cinema, this and black cinema, that, but it's been I've understood, like, it's been cyclical, where this happens every 10 years.
Yep.
For us to be conscious, every 10 years, my phone's ringing off the hook, so can you talk about the black renaissance?
Right.
10 years later, so Spike, I've been doing it for 40 years. So, to get around that, we have to get in those gatekeep positions where we have a vote. Because you can do it on the inside and the outside. I think we need to come from both ways.
That's right.
Martin, Malcolm, Du Bois, Booker T. It doesn't have to be one way to do it. It's the same goal.
I got no problem with brothers and sisters who have look, Van Jones has a bi-weekly show on CNN. Yeah. Joanne Reed, Don Lemon.
It's all good.
Charles Payne at Fox. That's fine.
All good.
But my deal is, We also got to have it over here where if it's did Gregory dies and we go, we're going to live stream his funeral. Nobody else was there doing it.
They wouldn't do it.
NAACP convention. I had my cameras. We were there. No other media is there. Mm-hmm. And my deal is stuff was happening there that was important conversations. And again, that's and so folks and I've been.
So you are a gatekeeper.
Yes.
And that's what we need.
My deal is, and we're bringing these stories. We're bringing I ran to this sister from Cleveland. Her two sons, she has eczema. Mm-hmm. Her two sons were trying to figure out how to help their mom with eczema. Mm-hmm. They carried their own soap company. Mm-hmm. I ran into them. We put them on, did an interview with them. I got an email. Man, we've been getting orders from the interview. Mm-hmm. If we're not there, they don't get the kind of publicity. And I'm putting them on my social media platforms, mm-hmm. 2 million people. That's black-owned business.
That's how it's got to be. My brother.
That's how we do it, baby. That's how we do it.
Did you go to Morehouse? Whoa. You sound like a Morehouse man.
Hold up. I went to Texas A&M, but we had maroon colors.
Aggie, right? The Aggies?
But we had maroon. Maroon
and white. Maroon and white.
Absolutely. Let's talk about this movie, Black Klansman. When did you first hear about this story?
When Jordan Peele called me up. I never heard of Ron Stowe, never heard of the story, I never didn't know of the book, to read the book. And Jordan, you know, called me up and he gave me a 6-word pitch. High concept. Hollywood. Black man infiltrates KKK. That was it.
You like, sold?
Nah, first I said, is this true? Then after that, I automatically thought of the David Chappelle skit.
Right, right.
But he said, Spike is true. And I said, I'm interested. And here we are today. You know, and it's very, very happy. You know, we've been blessed with the reception to this film. And been blessed.
I mean, it is a hell of a concept. I mean, right.
High concept.
When you hear it, you probably thought, that's fictitious.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, it actually happened. Then you got the whole David Duke part and all that. I mean, it's real.
Strange but true. it's still, I still shake my head that this thing actually happened. And I met Ron Stallworth, and so beautiful brother. And what's hip about this film, I feel, is that even though it takes place in the 70s, it's still very contemporary, you know.
Oh, absolutely. You know,
so that was the key, because I didn't want people to think, especially the young audience, like, oh, this is going to be a history lesson. I don't want to see that old thing. But we had to try to, we had to freak it a little bit, you know, for to show that this stuff is not new.
Right.
It might be dressed another thing, you know, and it's slicker, but it's the same stuff.
Well, when you, it was interesting watching the film, and I had my three of my nieces with me.
Mm-hmm. What are their ages?
And they are 21, and twins are 14, starting mm-hmm. their freshman year in high school.
Uh-huh.
And so we're watching the film, and in it, you know, they're talking about COINTELPRO and shutting down the Black Panthers. And just today, I posted a story that came from, I think, The Guardian of these 8 Black Panthers who are still in prison 46 years later. And the story is, will they ever be free?
What are the charges?
Some of them murder, some of them other charges, and a lot of these cats were in solitary confinement 10, 20, 25 years. Mm. I mean, America is still scared to death of black power.
Yeah.
Freedom.
Freedom.
And black folks who will actually pick a gun up. I mean, because they changed the gun laws in California.
They had to.
The Panthers read the, well, look, we can carry long rifles, as long as they point it in the air.
Right,
they
were like, UEP Newton.
Oh, no, we got to change the law. These Negroes, and they figure out how to use our laws to benefit them.
Yeah, I mean, we have a line in the film where police officer, the chief says that he agrees with J. Edgar Hoover, the biggest threat to the security of the United States of America, Black Panthers.
Which is crazy.
Crazy.
So, at what point did you say Charlottesville?
That happened before. In fact, it was two days ago, a year ago, August 12th, Sunday, 3 days ago. And I was at Martha's Vineyard, and I was watching CNN, and I just cannot believe that I just witnessed American homegrown apple pie, blueberry pie, cherry pie, homegrown American terrorism.
White, domestic terrorists.
Domestic terrorism. That's what it was, no matter what anybody says, that domestic terrorism. So David Duke, Agent Orange, I don't say his name, the neo-Nazis, alt-right, and the Klan, they gave me the ending for the film. That was, that's...
So when that happened...
We didn't start shooting until September.
So this literally happened...
August 12th, three days ago.
A month before you started shooting.
Yes. But I knew I wanted that ending, but I still wanted to get Miss Susan Bro's blessing. She's a mother of Heather Heyer, who was murdered. And she...
And you reached out to her?
Reached out to her.
What did she say?
Well, you know what we know she told me? She said, Spike, I'm very happy to give you the, you know, permission. But she said, I'm getting a lot of flack from black people, like, saying, why is your daughter getting all this publicity when black people getting killed all the time? And I really said, you know what, don't listen to that, Mr. Bro, because that's insane.
There's also black people who don't understand history.
I mean, black...
James Reeb was beaten to death.
I know, what was the lady's name from Detroit?
Viola.
Yes. So...
Head blown off. Dr. King gives a speech on the steps of the Capitol, mm-hmm, in Montgomery. She's driving one of the workers back,
yeah,
to Selma. Three Klan would pull up in the truck, blow her head off.
We go to John Brown. So that's just an ignorant statement. I try to tell her that, please, not all black people think like that. Your daughter's love, your daughter's a martyr. And so please just get that. I mean, mm-hmm, don't listen to that. That's craziness.
And it was, it felt, first of all, I can tell you, as somebody who appreciates film, I mean, I'm watching this, I'm not feeling 1970s. Sure, I'm looking at clothes, I'm looking at hairstyles.
The afros? Did you have a fro?
Oh, I had a fro.
Like this?
Oh, like that.
Yeah, no, yeah, the Michael Jackson or Jermaine
Jackson.
Mine was
real curly. I had a really soft one, too. And I had to put nothing in mine. So I had that natural.
No, you had to put no afro sheet in it?
No, my stuff.
Beautiful people.
Oh, I had that
use
natural
afro
I'm
sheet.
I'm talking about it was, I had a good one. I had a good one, too. I had a bigger one. Yeah, mine was way bigger than my brother. My brother was more like
John David
in the film.
Right.
Yeah, mine was way more curly. Way more curly.
What's my man's name from the Ohio Players? His was to the side.
No.
You know what I'm talking about?
My dad.
What's that guy's name, though?
Sugarfoot?
Yes, Sugarfoot! His afro lead to the side.
Daddy wouldn't allow that. That was limitations to the afro. Daddy was like, no, you have a regular ordinary fro.
Sugarfoot!
Sugarfoot passed away a couple years ago.
He did?
Yeah, dog. But perform up to the end. I saw he was on the Tom Joyner cruise at family reunion.
Yeah.
Out there with a cane, getting it in. When I'm watching it, you talk about that contemporary. And so even though I'm looking at the clothes and the hairstyle, I mean, it absolutely felt 2018.
Yeah.
Even at the end when you see the video, and even with that, did you, and it, so the video at the end, were there any recreations or did that come from Vice?
Some came from Vice, although we just put ads in the paper in New Charlottesville so everybody can be reporting now.
Right.
So people just send us stills and video. But a large part was Vice, but we got is a whole bunch of people contributed to the coda of the film, The End.
I said, and you said it, white domestic terrorists. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing how in this country, you can watch CNN.
Timothy McVeigh and all this.
MSNBC, you can watch all these networks, and if a Muslim, if an American Muslim, mm-hmm, did something, Muslim shoots five people, mm-hmm, or upset man. Mm-hmm. No, White domestic terrorists shot five people. And we've had in the past year, they tried to blow up a mosque in the Midwest. You've had all these different incidents. And in this nation, they just won't call it what it is.
It's not new, though. They call us three-fifths of a person. That's in the Constitution of the United States of America. Three-fifths. So it's the same old, it's the okey-doke. And people like you are in position to try to say that's BS, you know, because we gotta call what it is. Truth to power. Truth to power. You know and I know and they know this country was found, the foundation of this country is the genocide of Native people and slavery.
Mm-hmm.
That's the beginning.
Dinesh D'Souza has this movie out called Death of a Nation. Mm-hmm. He has a book out as well. So mm-hmm. I'm going to interview him next month with the launch of our show.
Uh-huh.
And so his whole premise is that Democrats are the party of racists. And we go on and on and on. My whole deal is, dude, that's America.
Mm-hmm.
The Whig Party, the Democratic Party, the Republican Party. But the operative phrase is white people. This nation, folks benefited from it. So whether you want to sit here and try to play this game of one party over the other, that's the reality for 245 years. Then you go through Reconstruction. Then you go 19 years of Jim Crow. I'm like, don't act like, mm-hmm. like one side was just pious and perfect.
Not at all. Not at all. But here we are today, though, with this guy in the White House.
And speaking of that, you didn't run away from that as well. He makes an appearance because, again, you're weaving these elements in and trying to get people to understand that don't think that this is America's past. It's America's present. And I keep trying to tell people that what's driving all of this today is 2043. When we will become a nation, that's majority of people of color. That's
you know, that's anxiety. I'm glad you brought that up because a lot of people slept on that. When the United States Census Bureau said by the year 2035, whatever with that.
Well, initially when they did it, it was like 2060. Right. People went, oh, this is about 30 years ago. People were like, man, I'm gonna be dead.
It's like that in California already
They went, I'm gonna be dead. Mm. Then something happened. Latinos kept having babies. Black people kept having babies. White folks stopped having kids. That thing went 2053, then 2050. I remember 2047, 2045, and it kept going down. Mm-hmm. Now we're seeing in several states the annual white death rate is higher than the annual white birth rate.
Mm-hmm.
And so every time I see one of these white anxiety stories, I said, y'all, you gotta be deeper than mustard on a hot dog. This is what's driving it. They are scared to death when they say we're losing our culture. No, you're losing your power. You are gonna have to share power, share money, share resources, and that's what's driving all this anxiety.
I agree. I mean, this is we're getting to nitty gritty, and as you said, and I'd like to co-sign it, piggyback. Agent Orange in the White House was also a reaction to 8 years of Obama.
In the history of America, black success has always been followed by white backlash.
Resurrection, you know, Reconstruction. So, and that's something that I just wish that as a whole, not just black folks, but just people, we gotta pay attention to history. I mean, so often, it happened before I was born. That's almost like suicide. You don't know what happened. I mean, everything should happen before you were born.
Right. but you look at Virginia. You look at
the Cathedral Confederacy.
Terry McAuliffe
extends
the voting rights to formerly incarcerated.
Mm-hmm.
In Virginia, the reason ex-felons could not vote is because in 1902, a state legislator said, this is to keep the darkies from voting.
Mm-hmm.
So you had all these governors who were defending a law, but the basis of it was from 1902. So when people go, oh, that's the past, I'm like, no. There are laws that are still informing us today, mm-hmm. based upon somebody who was a bigot, a racist then.
And you had amendments to turn around that stuff too. And now this guy is trying to take away amendments. So it's, we live in a crazy world. It's insane. And that's why I think this film, people respond to this film as well they are, because it kind of like captures, you know, the tone, the mood, the illness, the sickness that we live in. Because this, we're sick. A country that would separate families, separate parents from their children,
and take pride,
and take pride at, and put them in cages. Who does that? You can't claim to be the cradles of democracy and do some stuff like that. You can't do it.
I was on the train coming to New York, and I said, has Spike ever done a comedy? And I stopped thinking about, I said, and there have been comedic elements in a lot of your movies.
Right, right.
Is it your position that, look, there are people who make feel-good films, there are people who make romantic comedies, but do you see it as your mission? I need people to think.
But I think that you could do that in any genre. Mm-hmm. I mean, for example, Inside Man with Denzel. I mean, it's a heist movie, but there we talk about integrations. You know, we slip stuff in there. But I would not say, though, people have said this, been written about that Black Klansman is a comedy, a buddy cop thing. I think, I don't like, for me, I wouldn't use that word comedy. I would like
no, to, I wouldn't use that. Absolutely.
Yeah, humor. So I think it's probably done before. Do the Right Thing is a very serious film also, you know, has a lot of humor in it. So it's hard to do. We just have to get the right balance.
But what I'm saying is, but for you,
right.
You are deliberate.
Not every film. Not every film. I mean, the film, the autobiographical film about my family, Crooklyn, you know, that's just really just a small story about a young girl growing up in a household full of brothers, you know, parents. So it depends. It really depends on the film.
How crucial is it for us?
Very crucial.
To be able to see ourselves in a 360-degree way, and not just one way.
Well, it'll be telling the truth because, as you know, we are not one monolithic group. We don't think alike, look alike, talk alike. We're just as diverse as anybody else. And I think we get in problems. Problems arise when we get this. People think that we have to be, or we think that we have to be a monolithic group. Not everybody has it. All Black folks don't agree. All Black people don't like my films. So you just can't, you know, it's not one monolithic group, and we have to come to, I think, in better terms on the understanding that. And even though some people might, you know, say some crazy stuff, that doesn't mean they ain't Black. You know, that's just their... I'm not trying to make a defense.
No, I got you.
But that's just the... So it's hard to sometimes just say there's just one specific single Black voice.
So I got to ask you. So 2 weeks ago,
right,
you were in Detroit, mm-hmm, for the National Association of Black Journalists Convention.
Right.
You were there with the film that Saturday. That Thursday, Tyler Perry gave a masterclass. And in it, he brought you up. Mm-hmm. And he said when Tyler said I was cooning, excuse me, when Spike said I was cooning, he said I got all this criticism. And he said that people said, well, your shows are simple. And he said, well, that was a strategy behind it. Mm-hmm. And he said, look, Spike's from Brooklyn, sophistication. He sort of compared Zora Neale Hurston and Langston Hughes in terms of people like, well, Zora, why are you using that language? She's like, well, that's the language that I know.
But you know what, though? I would, you know, me and Tyler, I love Tyler, but I wouldn't say that's necessarily true, because even though people try to say, I was born in Atlanta. I went to Morehouse. So it's not like I spent my summers down south. If you live in New York, Boston, Philly, and your parents had grandparents down south, they ship your black ass down south. So my summers growing up in Brooklyn, New York, my summers are spent in Snow Hill, Alabama, and Atlanta, Georgia. So like I'm some alien to the south. That's not true. But I would like to say this though. I called Tyler up, and I said, Tyler, I never talked about this before. I said, let me come down to Atlanta. And so I flew down to Atlanta, spent the day at his house, his mansion. Incredible. And we just talked. And it was just me and him, nobody else. We talked for like 3-4 hours. Yeah. And we just came to understand, like, no, yo, we said, like, yo, we can't do this anymore. And we've been chill ever since. You know, it got to that point, and I called him up. You know, he said, you going to fly down? I said, yeah. You know, we've been cool ever since. Cool ever since.
Are you proud of what he's done? Building that studio?
Oh, yeah. The man used the word. He had a strategy. He's a mogul. Now I got all those studios that people are renting and stuff. So I got nothing for love, my brother Tyler Perry.
In that masterclass, and it was interesting what he talked about, what we talked about in the opening, mm-hmm. where he said, never leave your culture. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people, and when I introduced him, I said, let me be clear, y'all. Black people made him rich. Mm-hmm. A lot of times, you have African Americans who really want white validation. But if I can just cross over.
That's the death wish.
As opposed to being true. Why do you say that?
Well, I'm not gonna name no names, but there have been several African Americans in the history of this country who have wanted validation from white folks. And they did certain things to get that validation. And then something will come up. Well, white folks say, like, you're out of here. And then these individuals come crawling back. Oh, I'm sorry. You know, calling back to black community for forgiveness. This happened a lot. And being the forgiving people we are, you know, we welcome back in. Black folks are forgiving people. I'm sorry.
Yeah, we are.
We that's not DNA. You know, like, you can do something like crazy, but welcome, you know, back in the bosom. But you know what I'm talking about.
So with that case,
we ain't naming no names.
I'm gonna name this one since she's in the news. Will black people welcome Omarosa back? Cause she dropping dimes. No, she ain't dropping dimes. She dropping quarters and half dollars. What do you think? What do you make of all of this?
But here's the thing though. Again, I think a lot of stuff is meant to be distractions to keep us from focus on what's important. And if she had all those goods, then why should wait till she got fired, you know, but look, I mean, I really can't comment on that. With the president, Agent Orange, he put some tweets out about it today.
Called her a dog. Called her a dog, questioned her intellect. She got fired from The Apprentice 3 times. I mean, trashing left and right. And then a couple other black people who worked with him, they said, oh no, we never had any conversations. So Katrina Pearson goes on Fox News last night. Oh, I never had any phone conversation with Omarosa about the N-word. And then Omarosa went on CBS this morning and went, press play, and you hear Katrina Pearson on the phone call saying, yeah, he said it, he's embarrassed by it. It's kind of like, oops.
They had the tape on her? I missed it.
Pearson goes on to say, no conversation.
You know what? Was she singing that Shaggy song, Wasn't Me? It wasn't me.
I said it.
She's doing a Shaggy.
I said on MSNBC yesterday, I'm just letting y'all know. I said, tread carefully. I said, she crazy. She let these fools say, I never talked to her. Press play. When somebody tell you they got a bunch of tapes, you might want to be real careful. Your conversation.
What did she say after that, though? Once they play the tape.
Well, kind of a little hard now.
What'd she say? Was it me?
Right. I don't know. She probably gonna take it all spliced together. But it's But it's interesting, because look, I know Omarosa. I talked to her. I texted her. Look, I know many people. I know black Republicans. I know black Democrats. I know people. I know Fruit of Islam. Look, I've been in the black space all these years. And so I don't hate her. I don't despise her. But it's interesting to me also when we look at the reaction. Because I think to your point, Agent Orange, if you black, you get near him. Black folks, they ain't giving you the side eye. They giving you both eyes, and they're going to borrow a pair of eyes looking at you.
They're looking like this. or like this.
I mean, I had a pastor call me who was invited to that meeting with the black pastors who met with him. And he was like, no, I ain't trying to go near that. And then after it happened, he said, man, I'm so glad. He said, I didn't go near that. It's just,
here's my thing is that we're all going to leave this earth in our physical form. And when it's time to go to the upper room, do you want to be on the right side of history or the wrong side?
With the same life, the upper room.
The upper room, you know, and very quickly, I've seen someone like that. When I had to interview George Wallace, my documentary, Four Little Girls, he knew he was gonna go. So he was trying to come with all these lies of what he did for black kids, bought them books like that, but it was too late. He knew he was going to hell. I really believe that, because he was just coming up with some, I can believe he lied. I can believe he agreed to do the interview with me.
Right.
But he was trying to get some narrative, alternative
he wanted,
narrative.
He wanted salvation. He was trying, he tried everything.
Too late. When he stood at the door, University of Alabama, Vivian Malone, right?
Yep.
When he gave Bull Connor the wink wink, the Klan the wink wink, that was...
Because you ain't coming back from that.
You can't.
And there were black people in Alabama who forgave him, to your point. Who voted for him and reelected him governor?
Yeah, that's some Alabama Negroes, though. Yeah, I can't. My father was born in Alabama, so I can say it. Snow Hill, Alabama, between Camden and Selma.
When you look at just where we are, mm-hmm. and I've been saying this, we're 25 years away from 2043, mm-hmm. and I've been saying to black folks, study South Africa, because I don't want us to have demographic numbers, mm-hmm. but not be ready to take power, to assume power, to wield power, to use it. And folks ask me, they're like, man, but why you support charter schools? I said, look, I support any form of education that's working for us. Mm-hmm. I said, we don't have time, whether it's education,
we don't have the luxury. We don't have the luxury.
I'm like. A child that is born today is going to be 25 in 2043. We have to be in a state of mind where we are fully prepared for that moment.
Can I say this? It's like a smaller version of the giant statement you said. We weren't prepared at Obama's second term. Mm-mm. We were partying, and all the type of stuff. For 8 years, we were in a state of mental...
My phrase was, we never left the inauguration parade.
Yeah.
For 8 years, we were like... And here's what people don't understand, and I need everybody who's watching this to understand this here. I interviewed you for my book,
right.
The First President Barack Obama's Road to the White House, originally reported by Roland Martin. And I use that same quote in Essence magazine. You said, look, a light switch is not going to be turned on just because Obama's in the White House. Mm-hmm. There is work to do.
Because I was talking about this. The most insane thing, the most frustrating thing to me was this post-racial world.
Which was total bullshit.
It was BS. When our brother put his hand on Abraham Lincoln's Bible... at that very moment, there'd be some magical, mystical, hocus pocus, something, and racism and white supremacy, whatever, all the isms you want, it will be completely banished. That was some of the, that's probably the biggest skullduggery of modern time.
It was a con job.
Yes.
And I was on.
It was skullduggery, shenanigans. What's the other one?
Bamboozle. Led astray.
Run amok.
But I was on CNN, and I'm combating that, going, oh, what the hell y'all talking about? I'm like, again,
false narratives.
Not understanding history. And see, this is why also I tell these brothers and sisters, many of them who have now come after me on these networks, don't go on there just reading yesterday's news. Mm. Did the criminal justice system somehow get magically repaired when Thurgood Marshall was sworn in as Supreme Court Justice? No.
Hell no.
Did Virginia stop being a racist? Racism ended when Douglas Wilder was sworn in to be governor of Virginia.
Hell no.
No.
Give me Dinkins here in New York.
When these black mayors.
Give me Dinkins.
Gary Satcher, Richard Satcher in Gary, Indiana. Stokes in Cleveland. Maynard Jackson in Atlanta. Coleman Young in Detroit. Marion Barry in D.C. David Dinkins in New York. Mm-hmm. We can go down the line. It did not happen. And so I was, and it was crazy thing. It's like when you bring it up, because the hardest thing for me was sitting there, and black civil rights leaders told me, they said, Roland, we can't say nothing. Because if we turn around, we ain't got no troops behind us. Black people, I mean, Obama was Jesus 2.0 for black people. You could not.
The perfect Negro.
I mean, and again, I supported this president. Swung hard on the air. But I told folks, we fell in love with the first. We forgot he was the 44th.
Yeah, but we're acting like 44 is going to be like somehow there's going to be a new congressional act or whatever that's going to be able to have a third term.
Right. No. The point is, you get the demand of the 44th what you demanded of the previous 43. Mm-hmm. And understand, like all the people they kept saying, they were like, Roland, don't you miss him? I said, no. And Spine was like, what? I said, because the day he won, I knew he could only be there 8 years. Mm-hmm. I said, y'all?
But that's because we didn't have not seen ahead, looking, understanding history and knowing, like, this is just a period here.
Finite period.
We were not prepared. We thought he was going to be here for eight. My brother's going to be here for 8 years, and the Republicans, them people, they're like, You know when this started? Remember? Did you see that? What do they call that thing? The congressional with the writers. What's the thing? The dinner they have.
White House Correspondents' Dinner.
Do you see the one where Obama was killing Agent Orange?
Oh yeah.
That night. That's when it started. I truly believe that. That's the night he said, I'm going to get that.
Right.
I mean, people should go back and look at that. That's when Obama was right, telling them jokes about Trump. Damn. I mean,
was
telling jokes about Agent Orange.
Was destroying him. was destroying him.
And he couldn't get up. He had to stay there and take it.
Had to take it.
That's when that historians will bear me right. That's the night it started.
And what he did was he took the Pat Buchanan playbook, the George Wallace playbook. He pressed the buttons of white anxiety, pressed the buttons of these immigrants taking your jobs.
They're all rapists.
And all these folks, and he was pressing those buttons. And when you sit back and you study it, that's why I keep telling people, they're like, well, no. I mean, Katie Couric did some piece the other day, and some guy thanked her on Twitter by saying, thank you for not saying that all Trump voters are racist. And it was called white anxiety. I said, no, I need white folks to go deeper on white anxiety. There's history there. There was history. They feared what's going to happen to us now that all these slaves free. Mm-hmm. And then now what they didn't realize is the laws that were passed during Reconstruction, 13th Amendment, 14th Amendment, 15th Amendment, white wages went up after slavery. broke white people benefited from black people. In the history of America, broke white people always benefited from us demanding our full freedom because the laws were not just written for us. And that's why
And you can say it, you can expand that to women's movement too.
Oh, absolutely. Same thing.
The gay movement or happened on the back of the civil rights movement.
If you were gay, the same-sex marriage was passed because of the 14th Amendment Equal Protection Clause. That was a Reconstruction Amendment. Mm-hmm. And I've given speeches. White women, Title IX passed in 1972, which opened the professional schools to women to become doctors, lawyers, engineers. If you ask the average woman, where does Title IX come from? They can't tell you. There was a provision of the 1964 Civil Rights Act, which black people died for. And also people got to understand, every single one of those acts, Civil Rights Act 64, Voting Rights Act 65, Fair Housing Act 68, was preceded by black blood.
Yep.
Black people had to die. They think it was like the marches. No. There were actual riots that led to deaths, and they were like, "Hold up, we got to pass something."
Mm-hmm. And I'm LBJ.
But if you don't, but again, these people who walk around who ain't read a history book,
the gay white history book. How about just reading? Period.
Well, that's a start. That's a start. That's why the one time I did real time with Bill Maher, the one time, I turned to the camera, I said, "Read a damn book." Maybe that's why I ain't been invited back. I don't know. And that was October 2014. So I'm like, Bill, invite a brother back.
How old are you?
49. Be 50 in November.
I'm 61, so we're basically the same generation. I just wanted to say it's my education. Growing up in Brooklyn, New York, on my block, Big C, even I just think black communities all together, we never ever made fun of the people who were smart.
Mm-mm.
We never ever said, you acting white, you talk white, you're an Oreo, you're a South. We never ever, in my block, if you were smart, you got love just as much as you if you were a great ball player or you know how to talk to ladies. We never ever ever made fun of anybody that was intelligent, that was about their books, that was about their education. And I think crack turned the whole thing around.
Yeah.
Crack, I mean, we're still dealing with the crack epidemic because you had children who were left their own devices to grow up, and they had children. You know, that story is not really been. It's not. It's
well, because it changed generations.
Yes,
it changed.
I mean, there's always been drugs in the black community, but crack people lost their soul.
And when I talk about that period of black success, followed by white backlash, I put crack in that. Because Maynard Jackson elected in 1973, Jackson, Young, Berry, his whole group of black mayors.
You left something out. Morehouse man.
Okay. All right. Well, Maryn Berry, Fisk University.
All right.
Was a chemistry major. Mm-hmm. So he got you on that one.
Yeah. and the bitch set him up.
But you call them Morehouse men, but Maynard and Marion were also both men of Alpha Alpha. But the thing is that period, what happens? Black success, Reagan gets elected in 80, crack, Contras, okay? And again, that period of success. That to me, I think people have to connect. I got it, so we got a few minutes left. I got to ask you this here. How did it feel to sit there and go, I'm directing Denzel's son. I was directing the daddy.
It felt very natural because I directed Denzel's son in Malcolm X when he was 6 years old. He's one of those kids at the end that says, my name is Malcolm X. It's a blessing to work with Denzel on Mo Better Blues, Malcolm X. He got Game, Inside Man, and now to work with his son, who's an amazing actor. I've been saying this lately, but I'm gonna say it here, is that, you know, people talk about this, that's the cliche. To be honest, a lot of times cliches are based upon truth. And the cliche I would use now, talking about Denzel and his son, the fruit don't fall far from the tree.
But he wanted to also make his own way. He talked about
he had to. He had to. He had to be an athlete.
Right, going, you know, going the football route.
Yeah, you know where he played? You know what school he went to?
Yeah, he went to Morehouse, I know.
look, can I do this? The house.
I know he went to
Morehouse. Where did Dr. King go?
I know he went to
Morehouse. Where did Dr. King go?
Also an alpha.
Where did he go? Where did Samuel Jackson go?
I know he went to Morehouse.
And with Moses. Dear old Morehouse.
This is turning to a Morehouse PSA. That's what it's turned to. And all the rest of y'all out there who are proud Morehouse men, send a damn check back.
Uh-oh.
I ain't got a problem. Now look, I didn't go to HBCU.
No, you could. That could go.
But the thing I tell people,
the black schools altogether.
Right.
Yeah.
Florida A&M, only 5% of their graduates give back. Wilberforce 9%. Claflin is the example. More than 50% of Claflin alumni annually give back to the university. So I created the hashtag HBCU Giving Day. People are like, but you didn't go to HBCU. I said, yeah, but I'm black. I said, just
you know, that type of thinking is so ignorant. I mean,
I didn't have to go to HBCU to cut a check. I've done 16 commencement speeches, 14 HBCUs. I'm like, yo, if you black, you black. Support education. First of all, people saying Denzel's son, he's got a name, John David Washington. Mm. And also shout out to Paulette, because you know, got to give mama some credit.
Got to. Tanya Lewis Lee,
bad
too.
Bad sister.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Mm. That's right. First of all, to tell her wife hi. So so did she tell you when we met at CNN?
Mm-mm.
Okay. So I don't know if she wanted me to tell you. Whatever. So it was something you were doing. We were talking. She's like, you know, I don't know. I want to go here, you know. It was I think the children's book she asked. She was kind of like, you know, we've done these interviews and, you know, most of the time they want to talk about Spike, about movies. And so I said, okay, come on. I said, come to CNN, we're going to go to the cafeteria. So we sat down, we about an hour and a half lunch on our concept of Me, Inc.
Mm.
The concept of Me, Inc. You being your own shareholder, your own company. And so we sat there and we were just, it was just back and forth. So her book, her health initiative and stuff along those lines. And so, and I just said, Tanya, look, I said, you got to have a Me, Inc. philosophy.
Mm.
And we just had this long conversation.
Thank you.
I'm serious. I'm telling you. And what happened was, and I said, look, what's Spike doing? Great. I said, but look, you got amazing things. I said, have that vision. So what would happen is, so like once a month, I'd be like, how's Me, Inc. going? And like every time we've seen each other since, I would go, what's up, Me, Inc.? Yeah, we had a conversation.
No, thank you for that.
Not a problem. We had a conversation.
Thank you.
Just your thoughts, real quick.
Mm-hmm.
Aretha Franklin. She's health is declining.
I found about that this morning, and I've been like in a semi-daze. I mean, and here in the afternoon, I found about like 8 o'clock this morning, and the Queen of Soul. Detroit, Detroit. How did Barry Gordy let her get it? Was she signed to Motown first? I think so.
Was she signed to Motown?
I think so. Anyway.
Well, first of all, I mean, I'm always connected. Well, you can keep talking. I will check.
Well, that was one that got away, but.
Also, you know somebody turned away Gamble and Huff.
What was that?
And when they got an award, and Barry Gordy did a video. He's like, I'm still looking for the fool who told Gamble and Huff they couldn't come right for Motown. He said, what were they thinking?
Well, then there wouldn't be Philadelphia International then, right?
That's true.
The Beautiful Brothers, too. But Aretha, I had the pleasure of working with her one time. Aretha sang the end credits song for Malcolm X.
Yes.
The classic Donny Hathaway song, Someday We'll All Be Free.
Yep, I got the soundtrack, yep.
Yeah. But I love Aretha. And you know what? We really got to give our giants love. I know people use the word flowers and roses, but we can't be waiting till people on their deathbed, you know?
I agree.
We can't do that, we can't do that. We have to let our giants, our kings, our queens know that we love them and their love while they're here on Earth. I mean,
Also, no, she was with Columbia. Right. She was never with Motown Records.
My bad. Sorry.
Right, but you're right. How that happened? Yeah. First of all, you're right about that because it's just like for me, it's so people have I've known now for 10 years, and people literally while we're talking, people are literally texting me trying to get updates on her condition. And what's interesting is hold on 1 second. Literally, folks, we are live. So one of the local affiliates there is saying that she's passed.
Aretha?
That's what, So I know we live, folks, but this is what happens when. Hey, Doc, one of the local stations there is saying she's gone. Got it. Cool. Let me let folks know. I got it. Thank you. All right. No, she is not passed. No. It's not true.
Well, we gotta say our prayers.
You talking about our icons?
We got to. Because I say this all the time. There's no guarantee you're gonna wake up in the morning.
Right.
There's no guarantees. And I think of people like I've met over the years, great, great people, and like when they pass, I should have said, you meant a lot to me. Because people are busy, you don't wanna infringe on them, but
I do.
But
sometimes
you just gotta like move.
No, you
and
do.
Can I speak to my brother, my sister for a second,
do.
And just give him a hug,
yes.
And say I love you.
Yes.
And then don't make it to production. Get the hug, step.
That's it.
Hug and step, and they can feel that. They can feel it's genuine.
Oh yeah.
They can feel it.
It's for me, every time I get to see Harry Belafonte.
Didn't he do great in this film?
Oh, so I'm watching. So I'm watching the film.
So we didn't let people know he's in it.
You let nobody know. I'm watching the film. I'm like, I know that voice.
Because it starts as a voiceover before you see him.
I know. I went, Mr. B, it is? Doc. That was. I'm telling you. I called him. I called him. And first of all, one of the most iconic voices. And it's so crazy too because he'll call me back. And he's like, how you know this was me? I said, you the only person I know in the world who talk like this. And he just busts out laughing. Mm. But again, folks like him, I mean, you're absolutely right. Stevie Wonder, Lionel Richie. And so my deal is, these are our icons. Yeah, and what's weird, and how do you deal with this? How do you deal with meeting one of these icons? Because this was the case we had with Aretha. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with one of these icons when they're a fan of yours? Is it the weirdest?
I'm honored.
Dude, so here's what happened with Aretha. So 2007, my agent, Mark Watts, sends me an email. He's like, dude, we just got this email. Somebody saying Aretha Franklin really loves you and blah, 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 blah. He's like, about 10 minutes later, he hit me back. He said, okay, that wasn't a fake email. That was real. They just called the office. Aretha Franklin sends an email. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to let Roland Martin know I appreciate his work, what he does, what he stands for, what he means to our people. And then the next year, February 08, she's performing in LA, getting an Image Award, and she's at a concert. And some friends had a ticket, Beverly White and her husband Xavier. So we go to the concert. We sit in 20 plus rows back, whatever, enjoying the concert. And I was like, well, we're gonna go say hey. So we go and they walk us back, and we were the last ones to see it. And she goes, well, why didn't you tell someone you were here? I was like, I'm just here at the concert. She's like, well, I would have shouted you out from the stage. That's when our relationship began. Dude, she would just call me. She would just call me. Oh, 12:30. Spike, I ain't lying. 12:30 at night. I got to be up in 4 hours. I see a 248 number. I'm like, who called me from Detroit? I answer, Roland.
Yeah, that's me too.
Aretha. I just saw that Wendy Williams video you did, boy. That was something. And but I'm tired as hell. Mm-hmm. But it's the Queen of Soul. So you can't say, Aretha, I'm sleepy.
Can't do it.
Not for 20 minutes, Aretha going on the phone about sex. It's amazing. Cause you like, but you the queen. Mm-hmm. And you like my work? And bro, she would, in the last conversation we had, we talked on Christmas, and I sent her this video of my dad making this gumbo. She's like, well, I gotta get that recipe. So for 3 months, she's like, what a recipe? What's up with the gumbo? Then she asked me to come bring her some gumbo to the house. Mm-hmm. In March. Unfortunately, she went to the hospital that weekend, which I had never revealed before. But you're right. We got to show our love.
While they're here.
And just
in their physical sense, in their physical state, when they make that transition.
Because speaking of that, because it happened to me coming to, on the train station. How does it make you feel when you get black love? It is, I mean, I'm talking about when a brother or a sister, mm-hmm. had a brother in Atlanta. I don't know if he went to Morehouse. He worked at the airport. Walked up to me, he said, "Thank you." And I said, "Appreciate it." He said, "No, thank you," and walked off. Mm-hmm. And I tell people, I said, I teared up. It is something that's just amazing.
It's true. And there's the other side too.
Well, you got the crazies.
I was on Black Twitter.
Oh yeah, but you know what though? Even with that, that's fine, mm-hmm. because, and I had never stated it this way, but Kevin Johnson did when he introduced me in Sacramento. He said
the governor, I mean the mayor,
of San Francisco,
formula.
Yeah, he said
Phoenix Sun.
That's right. He said, "Black love is what fuels Roland do what he does." And it's true.
Yeah.
It's just, I mean, when dudes in prison, just got out of prison, says, "Hey, dog, you respect it on the yard. We watch your show every day." Mm. You're like, I mean, you ain't thinking about inmates watching the show.
Or the people that you reach, you know. But Aretha, I just think about Aretha.
Legend.
And what, I don't want to sound like these old fuddy-duddies, but people like Aretha, James Brown, Prince, Michael, they worked in their craft. And, I mean, and I'm not hating on anybody, but just putting out a video, that ain't like doing 5 shows at Apollo,
not one concert. They put on multiple shows. And gave it all.
And I just hope that the younger generation understands that you gotta put the work in. That overnight success stuff, you gotta put work in. You gotta be committed. I mean, you think about the time that the James Brown and the John Coltrane or Mike, I mean, that was their whole life. And
right.
They worked at it. They worked at it. They worked at it.
Last question.
You got to put it in. You got to put the work in, no matter what you're doing.
Netflix has picked up She's Gotta Have It, second season.
Yeah, we just finished shooting the second season.
What is it that you haven't done that you
a musical.
Do? Really?
Yeah.
On what?
Well, hopefully my school days be a Broadway musical.
Who you talking to, Kenny Leon?
Nah,
who you talking to?
I'm going
to
direct it.
You're going to direct it?
Yeah.
Mm.
I mean, that's a musical. People.
Oh, no, that was.
When the movie came out, they would say it should be a musical.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. Now it came out in 88.
Yeah, I still remember that scene.
Which one? The butt scene?
No, not that one.
What's he talking about?
T-shirt and all of them dresses.
Oh, yeah. Be alone tonight.
Yeah. Ooh. They would kill it. I can see that scene right now.
I know you can. Jasmine guy.
I can see that scene. I can see that scene right now. I can visualize that scene right now. Spike, always a pleasure, man.
Thank you, thank you. And congratulations on this, man. You do a great job. You're a freedom fighter, gatekeeper, and getting the word out. A lot of times we're not getting at the real, not getting the really real, we're getting the okie doke.
That's right.
Go ahead.
We're gonna do this here while we still live, whatever. Just look into that camera right there. And I want all you gotta say, I'm Spike Lee, and you're watching Roland Martin Unfiltered. Henry, you ready? No. Lead the feet up. Lead the feet up. I direct too, Spike.
I know.
Okay, I got you.
Ready? What's up, this Spike Lee, you're watching Roland
Martin Unfiltered.
What's up, this Spike Lee, you're watching Roland Martin's Unfiltered.
Do one to one, just Roland Martin Unfiltered. Your name in it.
Okay.
Here we go.
What's up, this Spike Lee, watching Roland Martin Unfiltered. You dig?
There we go.
My man.
We'll go back here. Spike.
Thank you.
Good luck with Black Klansmen.
Okay.
Folks, tweet it out. Go watch it. Buy the ticket. No damn bootlegs.
Yep. Don't be getting no Meg on your tickets.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. He's got it. Whatever the biz, he's on it. Whatever it is, he's got the scoop, the fact, the fine.